So with your permission, I begin. The participants are joining. Namaskar. Good afternoon to one and all. And I, Namrata Bajaj, welcome you all on behalf of Indrashil University to the webinar titled Future Trends and Opportunities in Healthcare Sector. For this webinar, I like to welcome Sri Amit Dholia, who is CEO at MAPS, Yogi Sri Maharaj Hospital, Ahmedabad. I also welcome stalwart in healthcare sector, Dr. Ashwini Bora, who is also Program Director of PGDHM at Indrashil University. I welcome Dr. Bharti Dave, she's Dean, School of Science at Indrashil University. I also welcome Dr. AP Vyas, who is Dean, School of Engineering at IU, and Mr. Abhinand Pandya, who is an MITian, Strategic Project Manager at IU. As well, he has very long experience in healthcare sector, especially in Apollo Hospitals. Again, I welcome the entire gamut of audience who are witnessing this webinar and attending this webinar. When the root is deep, there is no fear from the storm. And this is what we at IU feel, that we are strongly supported by our founding chancellor, Dr. Rajiv Modi, as well our provost, who is Dr. J.S. Yadav. He's globally famed, noted scientist in organic chemistry. Now, to begin with, I invite Mr. Abhinand Pandya to give a brief introduction of Indrashil University to the audience. Over to Abhinand, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you all. I think probably you are able to see the slide over here.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so good afternoon to everybody and welcome to this seminar about launching of our postgraduate diploma in hospital management. In last 2.5 years, we have seen that how important hospital is, especially with the pandemic things. And we have been fighting day in, day out for beds. Luckily, with the staff which is behind the hospital, and it has gone through a tremendous thing, and we have realized the importance of healthcare worker. And looking to that part, Indrashil University is to launch this important program with the stalwarts in industry. And to start with that part, I would just like you to go through a brief about Indrashil University. It started in the year 1951, Cadila Pharmaceutical, you know, Chemicals and Drug Intermediate Laboratory, by Sri Indravadan Modi with his wife as the first employee. He started with bicycle. He used to go there. His wife was the first employee who used to help him in making medicine. He used to go sell it to pharmacist, meet the doctors, and that's how the humble journey started. And, you know, he went to become Cadila. It's a brand name in our society now. And the idea, this thing came in the year 1943, because when he was not able to give medicine to his one of the cousin brother, and he died in a small village called Hasod, where we presently also run a very trust hospital, so that nobody is able to die because of shortage of medicine or healthcare. And that's where he said that I will be providing you affordable medicine to each and every person in the India. That's where, you know, the small spark started in 1943, which led to the institution. And that's why post him, the founding chancellor, Rajiv Bhai Modi, he said that chairman, sir, you know, fondly I call him I.M. Modi, sir, as the chairman, sir. He was imbibing Gita in himself. So his two motive, he has taken, you know, preaching Gita to the whole world and starting a university, which is Indrashil University, Indravadan Modi and Sheila Ben, the founding force behind this university. That's how the university began in the year 2018 with noble cause that we will be providing you the education par excellence, so that everybody in the society gets the better education. And that's where, you know, our founder chairman Vasilan has come into picture. J.S. Yadav sir has been a stalwart in chemistry. Top 2% in the chemistry is with IU, and we are fortunate to have it. And IU is going to be a gamut of life science industries focus into education vertical. And that's where we have got very good deans like Dr. Amish Vyas sir is there, Dr. Bharti Dave Ben is there, and they are able to guide it. And we are starting with this vertical for hospital management and life care. Now coming to this small thing, in just a 2 year span, I was able to achieve a strong footwork in this thing, education. And we have been given a best young university award and both the batches of 2018 starting and 2019 starting has been placed well. 100% placement has achieved. We also have dual degree into engineering where you can study 3 years here and 1 year into USA and you get a degree from USA as well as from IU. We also have a collaboration with IIT Guwahati for semester transfer in BTech. And we are also going to have a dual degree program with Newcastle in MSc. So MSc chemistry again. So in a word, I can say that, you know, education par excellence is what we are focused on. And that's what you are going to put forward to. Now, somebody who is looking at that important juncture, why hospital management? So if you look at it today, there is an increasing demand from hospitals, clinics, treatment center to provide quality healthcare. I was, when I was working for a short time with Apollo Hospitals and they were making losses, both with my founder, I.A. Modi sir, then Dr. Modi, my mentor, and also with Apollo Hospitals founder, Reddy's, they were all there to provide quality excellence. And when you realize, you know, you cannot make mistakes with hospitals, you know, ek koi pan car vado hoy, car ni andar tamara char bolt hoy, ek bolt rahi jase to pan car chalse. But you cannot do that mistake when you are doing with life care. Everything is crucial. Quality is par excellence in hospital management. And that starts with each and everybody from nursing staff to administrator to everybody. And that's why some hospital give preference to nursing and medical degree, but there is an additional requirement for non-medical staff also who plays a crucial role in this value chain. You know, if you look at the staff, which is there on the duty manager, he's working day in, day out, or you look at the pharmacist guy, they are all working day out. So healthcare management professionals find themselves working in very large hospital facility, and such hospitals have very high demand for workload, and that is going to be future. And today, the government has realized the importance of healthcare worker, and it is now getting corporatized. And the demand for you is going to be huge when you go through this modular course curriculum of theoretical, practical, and learning experience into hospitals. If you look at why IU makes you focus apart, because it is more of future-driven, unique classroom-based pedagogy, complemented with hands-on experience in form of field trips, seminar, internship, and company project. That's what we are focusing on. You know, there are four pillars which we are working on. Intensive classroom instruction, project work, industry experience, strong management network with the hospitals. That's what I am thinking, that you kids or maybe the students who are there are going to imbibe, and you are going to be the future leader in hospital industry. And what are the first steps for you to enter this corporate world is, first, you must freeze which institute you are going to drive. Then you must choose carefully your Dronacharya. For every student who is passing out, there has to be a blessing from a good Dronacharya. And that's why I feel the Dronacharya like Ashwini Ben is there. Our faculty like Namrata Ben and others are there. And the faculties like we are thinking, Amit Bhai is there, Abhijat and others are there who are going to guide you to develop your future skill set. So once you develop that future skill, you are going to be in huge demand in the corporate hospital. And that's where you start off with your ladder into the corporate journey. That's what I feel you must go through that, wherever you go. And that's where I feel you must boost your career with the industry and must choose the right pathway for hospital management courses. Now I would like to not go through detail of everything, but I would like to listen to the stalwart in the industry, both Ashwini Ben and Amit Bhai. Thank you.
Thank you, Abhinand sir, for beautifully setting the context of this webinar. And it's time now to invite Ashwini Madam before I invite Amit sir for giving the overview of healthcare sector as well the PGDHM program we are going to offer at Indrashil University. So over to Ashwini Madam.
So good afternoon, all of you. I will not take much of the time. I will give you the short account of industry, because now we call it a healthcare sector. Still, it is not industry, but now it is becoming profit-making industry. So there is a paradigm shift from philanthropic to profit-making, because private sector has emerged. So far as we were only depending on the public sector. And public sector, we required only administrative skills. But when in private sector came into picture, people are paying. And so the customers, the patients, they want the value for their money. And that is why this sector, private sector, goes through, they are passing through the change. Because now the employees require managerial skills. And this industry is growing at a very tremendous pace. If you see the size of the market, it will reach USD 372 billion by 2022 and to 854 billion by 2025. So hospital healthcare industry will be at the top position, and it is said that in coming years, hospital sector will leave behind the IT industry. So healthcare will be the first growing industry in the world. And if you talk about India, we are also changing from three-tier structure to a most modern structure because of the emergence of the technology. And the hospitals are growing at CAGR of 16.17%. So very high rate. And along with the hospital diagnostic, other medical equipment, so all these areas under the umbrella of healthcare, they are also growing. It is said that diagnostic industry is expected to grow at CAGR 20.4%. And now government has allowed us 100% FDI for all greenfield projects. So if you take the example of Aster Group, again, Dubai, Aster Group is basically from Kerala, but their headquarters is in Dubai. So another is Dubai-based group is Abraj. Abraj Group, they have started taking the 72% holding in CARE Hospital, C-A-R-E, CARE Hospitals in Hyderabad. So now government is also promoting, and the hospital chains, they are also on the road of expansion by expansion in terms of new services through technology platforms, use of new generation tools for diagnosis, tie-ups with insurance companies, geographical expansion, and the focus on pharma. So now selling is an outdated thing. It is restricted to public sector. And in private sector, we are marketing. We have to focus on the customer satisfaction. They become loyal to the organization. So the service sector perspective started with the private sector. And because the hospital is a 100% labor intensive sector, so employees' quality affects the output of the hospital. So hospital has to develop the quality employees. And people who are working in the hospital, right from the sweeper to the top person, they should be skilled and knowledgeable. So we focus more on the skills. That if skills are developed, then the quality we can achieve. Because now everybody, when they are paying, they focus on the quality. They relate with the money which the hospitals are charging. So the quality is equated with the price. And that is why this program we have started to develop the good executives and good managers. So our program is three trimester program. Trimester system is there. There will be three semesters and 1 year program, part-time post, part-time evening program. This year we will be taking the lectures online, and at the end you have to go for the survey project in whatever hospital you feel comfortable. You can take any topic for your research work, right from IPD management to pathology, radiology, quality management, even the dietary services. Because now in a hospital, it is a mall concept. Multispecialty, if you see the corporate hospital, it is more like a mall. Aapko jo bhi service chahiye, you are getting that service, orthopedic, pediatric, any services. And people are becoming more aware about what they are getting. So this program is focused on developing and grooming the good managers. So we are focusing on the skill development because it is a management part, because administration and management both are different things. In administration, you are doing whatever work is allotted to you. But when it comes to management, you should know or you should develop the skill that you, how you are getting the work done by the others. So manager has to take the decisions. They have to guide. They have to meet the team and how you become more efficient and effective. Because useless, because in physics principle, we are doing same thing in the hospital. We go for lean management. So in lean management, we are trying to reduce the non-productive activities. And so we are trying to develop the skills so that the students who study our program in the hospital management, they become efficient and they know what is right and what is wrong and the right thing doing at the right time. So they become more productive. It is not like that you should be there in the hospital for 8 hours and you are doing nothing. So self-development is very important. Another thing is empathetic behavior we are developing, because in hospital you are dealing with the sick people. So you have to be efficient. You should have the commitment and dedication, ethical approach and your attitude. So we try to change the attitude of the students. And we explain, giving the example, live example, and some of the cases we present and tell the student through those case study analysis. And we do our best in developing analytical, logical, and reasoning skills. Mainly these are the three skills. But under these three skills, we are developing listening skill, soft skill, ability to work in a team, leadership skills, adaptability. Adaptability means healthcare is ever-changing industry nowadays. And so adaptability and flexibility, that we are trying to develop decision-making. Decision-making means we focus more on the rational decision-making, positive attitude, and the stress management. Okay. So we include the part of the organizational behavior, that is the applied behavioral science, in this area to develop the managers or the employees to have this empathy factor, reliability, responsiveness, assurance factor, because when patients come to you, they don't have confidence. They are worried about their life. And so you have to give them the assurance that they have come to the right place. So this program is more focused on connecting knowledge with the skill so that your output brings the satisfaction and the hospital gets the benefit of the quality employees. So healthcare now, after COVID, there are so many challenges and so many avenues have opened up. Because of the technology, we are now shifting on technology platform like online consultation. We never thought of consulting a doctor online, but now we have to get acquainted to the technology. And telemedicine also we were not developing, but now we don't have any other choice. So artificial intelligence, now we are moving towards mobile and wearable equipments, diagnostic things. So these are the areas which have opened up. And I think that Amit bhai will very nicely explain to you that what will be the trends and what will be the future of the healthcare industry with the combination of traditional treatment part as well as the latest technology based services.
Thank you, madam, for briefing this program. And now it's time for our speaker, keynote speaker today, that is Dr. Amit Dodia. And he is a keynote speaker today. And before I invite him, it is...
We are in a transition phase and COVID has helped us to grow.
It seems there is some net issues with Dr. Ashwini. Madam, are you there? Amit sir, with your permission, I would like to introduce you and perhaps then you can take it forward.
Please.
Yeah. So it is imperative for us to share the brief credential of the speaker, and I take the privilege of that. Amit sir possesses over 23 years of experience in hospital sector in addition to other sectors. Earlier, he had worked with the Asian Heart Institute and Research Center, Mumbai, in the capacity of AVP operations. He had also served in Gujarat Adani Institute of Medical Sciences and PAPS Hospital Surat in the capacity of Chief Operating Officer. His key competencies include hospital operations and management, value-driven decision-making, critical thinking, and problem solving, as well as he has very crucial and pertinent qualities in the health sector as the in the capacity of Chief Operating Officer. On the final note, it is worth mentioning here that he is Secretary of AHPI Gujarat Chapter, in addition to Advisory Committee Member of IPHG, and he is also Coordinator of AHPI Gujarat to CGHS, ESIC, and also which government of Gujarat floats the schemes. So the list of his achievements and association doesn't end here though, but I act contrite and invite Amit sir to listen from him. So over to you, Amit sir.
Thank you very much to all of the seniors and my colleagues. As you mentioned that the healthcare industry is changing post-COVID pandemic situation. So we all are aware and we all have faced a lot of challenges during this COVID pandemic. After that, healthcare industries, scenario is totally changed. As we say that everybody is thinking about digitalizations and any telemedicines and et cetera. So before we start this healthcare, I would like to share my PPT to also you can view this. So today's topic that alerted me is future trend and opportunity in healthcare sectors. So before we start this healthcare industry, so little we know about the healthcare industries. The Indian healthcare industry, which comprise the hospitals, medical infrastructures, then medical devices, biomedical equipment, clinical trials, outsourcing, telemedicines, health insurance, and all other. And as this Ashwini Madam said that the market is reached to $372 billion by 2022 and $800 by 2025. The healthcare industries we have followed is a universal healthcare model. Healthcare systems were derived in three legs, is a primary, secondary, and tertiary level, which followed medical infrastructures, medical device, clinical trials, which I had mentioned earlier. The important thing is the future trends. After post-COVID, the entire healthcare scenario has changed. As we mentioned that in 2010, ISRO has introduced telemedicine, but at that time, we were not aware about this telemedicine. But nowadays, everybody is know about the telemedicines and teleconsultations. So this drastically changed just because of this COVID situation. Let's speak about the future trends. Increase awareness about the importance of behavior and healthcare. So after the COVID pandemic, many people have spoken more openly about mental health issues and their experience with care. We have noted that pandemic has created more awareness about behavior health and reduced the stigma associated with mental and physical health. We have observed that in 2025, individuals may feel as comfortable reaching out for behavioral health services as they do visiting their primary care physician for the flu or a physical injury. At present, we also facing a little bit challenges that so many parents and so many people are coming with the same issues in our hospitals, and not in our hospitals, but across the globe. And second is demand is louder, more happening. So second is also told us that we should have to think about this behavioral health. The second trend is easy access, quick response, and waiting time. So in that, patients are growing more aware about their health needs. They feel that they should have to focus quickly. They should have to listen quietly, and they should have to less waiting times. They all thinking about that we should have to reach very nearest healthcare centers compared to the far, far from their home. They don't want to travel much more nowadays. They want to do a digitalized in terms of billing and pricing. And they also feel that the pricing matter is not important. We have seen that there are so many patients had called us during this pandemic situation, and they ask us for the admission. But unfortunately, just because of the huge patients admitted in across the hospitals, so many hospitals have denied the admission. So that time they have said that I want to pay in advance 10 lakh, 5 lakh rupees, but you must admit us. But this is the fact we have faced during this pandemic. The second thing is that they are demand and quick services. They don't want to wait much more longer. Unfortunately, in our healthcare industries, we are depends on the doctors, but at the same time, the diagnosis service they want is many minimum time period. People more adopt proactive and preventive treatment based on hyper-personalized insights. They will tailor exercise and nutrition to help maintain physical and mental health while monitoring themselves using apps, wearable, and the likes. Because in this healthcare industry is now the digitalization as accepting much more speedy way. The everybody have now the wearable devices which monitors their vitals like the heartbeats, then blood pressure, then even diabetes and etc. The third most and important thing is the widespread acceptance of the telemedicine. As I said that the ISRO has introduced telemedicine in our country in 2010-2011. That time telemedicine devices, the cost was about 3.5 lakhs, which we have incurred in our Surat hospitals. But that time, the public and the doctor also not accepted this new technology. But nowadays, we have seen that there are almost an 80% rise in consumption of digital healthcare services after COVID-19. Include virtual urgent care, office visits, home health visit, technology-enabled home medication administrations also, they are now dealing with this telemedicine. The promising area of telehealth and digitalization is transforming medical data collection, storage, diagnostic techniques, treatment planning, surgical workflows, remote patient monitoring, and consultation. The volume of the health and medical data is expected to increase exponentially in the coming years. After reviewing the current scenario, we strongly believe that telemedicine is here to stay for a longer times. We as a country are now also realizing that this is the great help in bridging the gap of doctor and patient ratio. As we all know that in India, doctors and patient ratio is very huge compared to WHO recommendations. The government has published telemedicine practice guidelines on March 2022. It is now perfectly legal to provide teleconsultation by registered medical practitioners. Before COVID-19, there are so many doctors are denying telemedicine just because of their medical legal issue. But after that, the government has think and had discussed with so many agencies. And after that, they have introduced and they have legalized this teleconsultation by registered medical practitioners. According to the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare Department, they have predicted that in 2025, up to $119 billion health spending in the country could shift to virtual care. Telemedicine market only is expected to cross 5.5 billion by 2025 in India alone. We have dealt with so many telemedicine agencies, and in India there are top telemedicine companies which we have catered across the globe, like VidMed, Librate, Doc Prime, Call Health, Practo, 1MG. Many of us are known about all these names. Dr. Devi Shetty commented during my interactions that the COVID-19 has proved that the virtual care can work. We are excited about the potential for virtual care to manage chronic condition like diabetes and obesity. As we know that the Dr. Devi Shetty is very prominent doctor and very good thinker in healthcare, and they have so many advice given to the government, which is the one of the advice that he shared to government of India. In telemedicine, we have seen that top 10 healthcare industry stays in 2021 in terms of the IoT, the Internet on Things. The artificial intelligence is shared 18%, then Internet of Medical Things shared 17%, telemedicine shared 12%, and big data analytics shared 11%. As we have as a hospital managers, we know the importance of big data and analytics. In our healthcare sectors, we are depends on the data and analytics much more than the other marketing tools, because we know we are having a ready-made availability of data, that how many patients from which area, from which city, for which disease they have come in our hospitals, and on and above that, which doctors has cater to which patient. So this is the very important to growing the health hospitals particularly. Then the fifth one is immense technology, the immersive technology is to AV and VR technology. We must knowing that the virtualization this video setup, this is called immersive technology. Then after the 3D printing, the 3D printing is very dominant in particularly diagnostic sector and specific in radiology diagnostic centers. Then after the blockchain, again, this blockchain is a very important aspect, because nowadays the all patients' data are on internet. So people are afraid about their data. They don't want to share all this data through internet or to hospitals through internet. So that's why this blockchain is most important, because blockchain, what blockchains do, they're doing that data are in clustered manner. So nobody can access any single patient's data from single spaces. So this is called as a blockchain. Then the cloud computations. The cloud computing is again the data servers and the server server, because each and every hospitals and each and every diagnosis centers are not able to procure hardware of this to procure the, all the data, to save the, all data. So the cloud computing is most important. They save the amount, they save the spaces both. And the last one is genomics. The new arena personalized medicine is possible due to the advent innovation in genomics. Gene therapy and gene-based therapy solutions have revolutionized clinical medicine and specialty care for several unmet clinical needs. See, in future, we all are thinking and we all develop this genomics medicines, and this medicines is what? The specific, the patient-specific medicines that catered by the consultants. Then the next is telehealth and digital marketing. As I mentioned that this pandemic has almost entirely changed how the healthcare industry in India operates. With telehealth, hospitals are now also concerned about reaching patients online, how to deliver and protect the patient information. Healthcare practitioners and hospitals are now exploring new possibilities with digital media, and it is only possible by being visible online. We all are aware that the pandemic lockdowns, and that times we face a lot of challenges towards these patients. There are so many patients who wants to take treatment, but unfortunately they are not able to get it in hospital just because of the transportations and other issues. By online visibility, we've been having a strong presence over the web, which can happen through web solutions, mobile applications, Google Ads, search engine optimization, educational videos, and social media optimization. Then digital therapeutics are about to become a true medical alternative that will utilize communication management technology, apps, and software to improve the patient outcomes and help to lower the cost of healthcare. A few days back, I read this one article that Google has developed a intelligent tools, and through these tools, they predict that the patient's future conditions, and its result is almost 95% accuracy compared to our doctors are not diagnosing the things. So this is the strongest part of this digital tools. Then expanded adoption of artificial intelligence and machine learning in the administrative relief of the healthcare. We are expecting technology solution based on artificial intelligence and machine learning technologies to revolutionize data entry of electronic medical records as well as patient billing. Artificial intelligence is since long in our healthcare industries. A few examples is that the radiology diagnostics. So sonography machine, MRI machines are the part of this AI tools. AI-based workflow optimization use cases will represent more than 80% of the workflow market contribution. Example, the elimination of the unnecessary procedures and cost in patient care and hospital management, patient data and risk analytics, then claim processing, optimizing the drug discovery process. We have said this claim processing, this means is, you know, that the TPA now is upcoming this on behalf of the insurance companies. So what they have said, they have incorporated insurance policy, the terms and condition of the policy, and the patient's declaration, whether they have a pre-policy disease or not. So these are the considering during the claim processing. This is just because of through AI. As I said, the Google is already worked to use machine learning for predicting patient's death, and the result goes to a flattering figure of 95% accuracy, which is better than the hospital's in-house warning system. AI application across clinical and non-clinical use cases will continue to show hard results and further bolster. Another is the digital scribes. For example, use machine learning to analyze conversation between doctors and patients and enter the appropriate information into the electronic health record systems. This tools are developed by the Israel agency. I forget the name of this agency, but they have made fantastically. They have made three, four tools for heart patient, for blood pressure patients. Patient need to fix these tools on their hand, and Israel team has visualize and analyze all this data at their centers, and they call the consultant that this so-and-so patient is suffering from so-and-so. So you just cater this patient. So this is the digital scribes. Medical coders are also beginning to work with computer-assisted coding system. These solutions use artificial intelligence and machine learning to analyze charts and notes to identify which billing codes are most suitable. In India, there are health workers available in non-clinical parts, but in foreign countries, it is hardly to recruit this non-medical employees. So they have developed these tools. So the whenever the medical officers or the doctors are entered this ICD course, and on the basis of that, the billing codes are scrutinized from the ICD coding and bill is generated. So this saves the times and the money of hospitals as well as the patients also. The other trend is in future is proliferation of local clinics, small and mid-sized hospitals. Recently, research said that market retail clinics, small and mid-sized hospital market in the country to expand at a compound annual growth rate of 10.2% between 2020 and 2027. This is just because of the specialization of the consultants. Earlier, there was only a physician and surgeon was there. Nowadays, in physicians, there are so many specialties, endocrinologist, nephrologist, then psychiatrist, then other skin dermatologist, ophthalmologist, then urologist, then neurologist, then in neurology, there are neurophysician and neurosurgeons both. So these are the scattered in this specialization, and that's why we believe that the in future, small and mid-sized hospitals market definitely booming in the sectors. However, we believe that the corporate sectors are playing the key roles while the all doctors are available under one roof. So we have not denied about that, but in present scenario, we say that this specialization doctors are opening their hospitals in their way. According to expert, the value delivered by this clinic could increase through closer ties with traditional providers. Retail healthcare centers and clinics will continue to grow due to awareness in public and change education methodology. Specialization clinics will be key players in the near future. But the second one is the trend towards managing the health of the whole person. It means this healthcare leaders the opportunity for more patient-centered system that will support a holistic approach to care. Nowadays, these holistic words are more popular in that, not only in India, but in even across the world, because we all believe that during COVID, no any doctors, no any hospitals, no any nurses are able to data interoperability will be the key to making the vision a reality. As we observe, we often get process flow diagrams of data. Without all the data for a patient, we can't realistically reduce the total cost of care. Secondary care and tertiary care centers are playing key role. And how can we forget that Internet of Things and artificial intelligence? We must understand that healthcare industry will be the main source for Internet of Things and artificial intelligence platform usage. So these are the all future trends which we believe that this is the this will change entire scenario of the healthcare market. So after this trend, we must have to think that what we have at present. Look at the slides. These are the number of hospitals and beds available in India. There are private sectors and private sectors. So total number of beds available in India is approximately 19 lakhs, whereas the hospitals are total 70,000. ICU beds are available approximately 95,000, and ventilators are available almost 48,000. The distribution of government hospitals and beds. In rural rural area, there were 21,000 hospitals, whereas 265,000 beds. You mean to say that per hospital average 12.39 beds, wherein in urban area, there are 4,375 hospitals and 448,000 beds available. It means the 102 beds per hospital available in urban area. So this we'll discuss later while we take this opportunity. What we require? As per World Health Statistics, India have 1.37 beds per 1,000 people, which is below the global average of 2.4 beds. So this is the opportunity where in India, we have shortage of almost 30 lakhs beds. And it's if we convert into hospitals, say example, 250 bedded hospitals, so there will be 12,500 hospitals required. While on other, Sri Lanka has 3.1 bed, China has 3 bed, Thailand has 2.2 bed, Brazil has 2.4, USA 3.1 bed, and UK is 3.9 bed per 1,000 population. At present, India is spending 71,000 crores for health and family welfare. This is 0.34% of GDP, while we have targeted 2 2.5 to 3% expenditures of GDP. So there are the huge gap between what we are spending and what we want to spend. Now, let's take the opportunities. We discuss about this opportunity in healthcare sectors. A market vacated by a competitor. As I say that there are huge gap of hospitals and patient beds in India, and not even in India, in across the globe, there are 75 countries are far behind that India. So there are huge opportunity in that market. It's due to huge gap between demand and supply. Health service demand will remain continue up to at least next two decades. Just because of the population versus the hospital clinics, doctors are very less. As we say that any single 100 bedded hospitals has generated 220 to 300 employment. You just imagine that if 100 bedded hospitals are generating 220 to 300 employee, then assume that 12,500 hospital if we build, then how many employment has been generated? So approximately 37.5 lakh to 40 lakhs healthcare worker shortage as on today in India only, while in the globe it is 8 crore healthcare worker shortage. I'll explain in next slides. The rising proportion of lifestyle disease, such as high cholesterol, high blood pressure, obesity, poor diet, and alcohol. This is the against the opportunity. Fortunately or unfortunately, we are saying as an opportunity, but in terms of the patients, they are facing a lot of challenges just because of their lifestyles. People lifestyle is one of the challenges the world and doctors, and at the same time, simultaneously, it's opportunity for healthcare service industries. Number of patients of lifestyle disease are rising in day by day. We say that the lifestyle disease is heart disease, then COPD, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, then diarrhea, diabetes, and the cancer, wherein other major causes of death is during 1990, then non-communicable disease, that means lifestyle disease, were 37%, but now it's turned up to 62%. So you just assuming between 1990 to current year, there are huge gap, almost they have stayed from 37% to 62%. And save life expectancy also increase. So life expectancy will discuss on aging part, but as I said that the lifestyle disease is growing drastically, and just because of this growing, the healthcare demand is also growing accordingly. And aging population, as I said that during 1990, our age expectancy was 59 years. In nowadays, it is reached up to 72 years. So this aging factor is also a opportunity for healthcare workers. The global population age 60 years over and numbered. The number of elder persons 60 plus populations increased from 7.6 crores. It was in 2001, but in 2011, when we have calculated that increase up to 10.38 crores, it means 8.6% of India's population growing in aging population. So we assume during 2050, it will rise up to 31.9 crores population, which cross beyond 73 years. So this is the against biggest challenges for the government as well as the for healthcare sectors also, because we need to expand ourselves, we need to upgrade ourselves to cater all these patients. Another opportunity is new market segment that offer improved profit. As we said that before 10 years and current scenario and after 10 years, we are seeing that the healthcare sector changes drastically. Before 10 years, we have not think about this telemedicine digitalization. While current scenario, we are thinking about the telemedicine and digitalization. And after 10 years, we are thinking about genomics, then blockchains. So these are the new market segment which cater to and demand more and more healthcare workers, the qualified healthcare workers like the IT person, like the pharmacotherapist, they like the physiotherapist, and like any other management persons who need to handle all this market. Then new vertical, horizontal or niche markets. This is the very special opportunity in for healthcare markets. We said that the vertical market, what does it mean vertical market? Vertical market, just I give you example, this is the patient and doctors. It's called the vertical market because patient direct consult with the doctor. There are no any between any middle layers. Same thing is insurance. We are purchasing insurance from the direct insurance company through online portal or through the office or through the agency. But this is called as a vertical market. Similar is the banking. We are dealing with the bank directly. There are no any other layers between us and banking or any other agencies, right? Same thing is horizontal market. The horizontal market is, I give you just example, is a pen. Pen demand across any and all industries. There is no any scope other than this pens to write or write the pen or pencils and etc. So this is called as a horizontal market. The same market is applied in our healthcare sectors for patient. Without consultant, they will not treat it. This called as a horizontal market and niche market. See. Niche market is very, very, very effective for this healthcare sectors. I'll give you just examples. If within the market for shoes are many different segments, right? But shoes for vegan person would be a niche market, as would shoes for plus size or shoes for nurses. It's another segment. So it's called as a niche market. The product is specifically made for the specific persons. So same thing in healthcare sectors, the healthcare industries is made for the patient and public who have a disease. And increased emphasis on public-private partnership, as well as escalated adoption of digital technology. We all are aware about that public-private partnership, but we are not maybe aware about that the benefit of this PPP. At present in India, 160 hospital PSA CSC are running under public-private partnership. I'll give you some examples about this. The GCS Medical College, Gujarat Adani Institute of Medical Science, GCRI, then Atal Bihari Vajpayee Institute, then Vinoba Bhave Civil Hospitals, all are the few examples which they have run a public-private partnership. The huge infrastructure of the Indian public health system, lack of realizing its complete potential, partly due to inadequate expertise in managing the operations of the units. Then PPP operates on a huge volume, low margin model, which can ensure universal health coverage and provide quality care at affordable cost. See, again, if we adopt PPP model, then government is supporting us to provide a land, to provide a building, while the outsource agencies has run their specific department or specific area. Operation and management contracts are being handed over to outsource partners, and the recent example of Fortis managing SL Raheja is the best I can cite, because I have seen personally during I was in Mumbai. I have seen the performance, I have seen the opportunity also. There are unheard smaller operation and management run across the country. Reputed hospitals like Wadia and Masina in central and south Mumbai and others across the country have hired a reputed healthcare consultancy firm to do a quality gap analysis and help them streamline the operations and management and suggest way to bring out about better sustainability. So these are the opportunities in the current market in healthcare sectors. We just understand the healthcare market of India. Healthcare has become one of the largest sector of the Indian economy in terms of both revenue and employment. India's healthcare sectors has potential to generate, as I said, 27 to 37.5 lakh jobs in India between 2017 to 2022. And we assume that another 40 lakh jobs up to 2027. India's healthcare industry has growing a compounded annual growth rate of around 22% since 2016. Healthcare market in India is expected to reach $372 billion in 2022. The current market size of pharmaceuticals in India is $41 billion, which will reach by 2030 up to $130 billion. As I said, that the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare plans to create 10 lakh skilled healthcare providers by 2022. For that, the government has tied up with so many hospitals and the agencies to start small syllabus and small topics like the certification course of operation theater, certification course in CT technicians, X-ray technicians, etc. India's biotechnology market is expected to grow at an average growth rate of around 30% per year to reach up to 100 billion by 2025. As we proudly say that the fourth largest in Asia with 700 plus medical devices makers and top 20 among the world. The largest biomedical hub has established in Hyderabad in entire Asia. See, these are the opportunity which we have discussed, but before the conclusion part, we said the huge gap in healthcare sectors of healthcare workers in across the India. As per WHO Global Health Workforce Statistic, estimated healthcare workers, a demand in millions in 165 countries by region to achieve universal health coverage by 2030. So WHO has bifurcated in six segments and of entire world. In Africa region, 2.4 million healthcare worker requirement. In America's region, 15.3 million health workers required. Eastern Mediterranean, 6.2 million workers. Europe, 18.2 million workers required. In Southeast Asia, 12.2 million, it means the 1 crore 22 lakh healthcare worker required by 2030. And Western Pacific, like Australia and New Zealand countries, is a 25.9 million workers they have required to achieve universal health coverage. So you mean to say across the world, 8 crore healthcare workers requirement by 2030. It is a very huge gap and it is a very huge opportunity for healthcare workers. And if you achieve certain levels in healthcare industries, you no doubt and you no debate, you no deny any area. This is the job opportunities for this healthcare professionals. The healthcare management students have vast career opportunity according to Ministry of Labor and Employment. There has been a prospective increase in healthcare management jobs in the past decades, and healthcare sector is one of the largest sector in terms of providing employment. The healthcare industry is growing 17%, which is 3 times the current GDP growth rate in India. The mainly following industries are catered by healthcare professionals, for officers to executives, from managers to top seniors. Like the industries are like the hospitals, nursing homes, telemedicines, health insurance, pharmacy industries, lifestyle industries, e-health business, medical and diagnostic lab, medical devices manufacturers, and the opportunities like telemedicine, health insurance, pharmacies, we said. The opportunity we discuss about that. So I just give you a brief example. As per WHO, doctor population ratio is 1.34 in India, while WHO recommended the one doctor of each 1,000 populations, and nurses is 1.7. They recommended 3 nurses of 1,000 populations. So these are the huge gap. Dr. Pratap Reddy put it that the biggest challenge for him and Apollo is filling the void of human resources. The fast expanding domestic healthcare industry is the third largest employer, but it is severely short of manpower, according to him. As per Ministry of Health, there is a shortage of approximately 500,000 doctors, 1 million nurses, and the deficit need to be filled in the next 5 years. Such shortage will lead to exponential salary hike demands. So this I say, this is the opportunity for healthcare workers. It is a very good opportunity, and it will continue up to next 2 decades. So I request to all the students and the prospectives to select this healthcare sectors for the better and future prospects for your personal careers as far as for the healthcare industries. Thank you very much for giving me the opportunity. Thank you. I conclude my session.
Thank you, Amit sir, for this wonderful session, which was very informative. And before I invite for question answer sessions, may I request you to unshare the slide, sir? Amit sir, could you please unshare?
Yes, madam.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Yeah, so there are 3 questions. One is very pertinent. I think that is, can you provide DNYS course? This course is Robinson, sir, that is Diploma in Naturopathy and Yogic Science, I believe, if I'm not wrong. So if IU is ready for providing this course, also in addition to PGDHM. Abhil sir, can you hear me?
I think it's not clear. Hello.
Yeah, actually the question is that can you provide DNYS course, that is actually Diploma in Naturopathy and Yogic Science, I believe. So if IU is going to provide other than PGDHM course, that is what the question is.
We are going to provide a gamut of all the medical related courses going forward. This is going to be the first course which we want to start. We want to make sure that whatever we provide is par excellence and it is well accepted by the industry. And the faculty which we are going to bring to the board are more experienced and more practical. So we are going to go slowly one by one courses.
Thank you so much, sir. Second question goes like here. How likely is to take PGDM course in hospital management as our career? The lifestyle, the salary growth, and the personal growth, all these things are related to their career, that how far we are going to grow if we take up this course. So the question could be answered by Ashwini madam as well as by Amit sir. Madam, unmute yourself, please.
Sorry. It depends on the student, Namrata. Because if the students grasp so well and start developing their skills very fast, they can, after one or two experience, some of the examples are there, they have become chief operating officers. So how much you bring the result, output, and accordingly you grow. If you maintain the status quo, you have to be innovative, motivated, and apply or implement the theory concept with the requirement of the patients and how. So we have to think on the result, that is the customer satisfaction, patient satisfaction, patient and their relatives rather satisfaction. And accordingly, on the basis of the performance appraisal as well as potential appraisal, they are growing. So, Amit bhai, can you throw more light on it?
Yes, madam. And as we said that since last 10 years, we are seeing that healthcare is the second largest growing industries. Not only in terms of this size of the industries, but in terms of the opportunity in this industries. So every employee is getting a very good incentives and good increment year by year. As we say that every year, the first industries, the IT industries, who are giving almost 12% increment, while in the healthcare sectors is almost 10.9% increment each and every year. So this is the very good opportunity for these healthcare professionals and healthcare educators.
Thank you, sir, for adding on to this. And since you are into this profession, perhaps you only can justify the answer. I'm sure the this person who has, you know, posed this question might have been answered. The final question is MHA internationally valid as in USA? MHA is Masters in Hospital Administration, internationally valid like in USA. I just want to correct this, Krishna Shah, that it could be MHA instead of MHA, it is MHM. Let me correct that. So if the validity of this course is being questioned here.
So I'll just brief about that. Thus, MHA course definitely valid in abroad, even in USA. There are so many our employees are going abroad. However, they have to go through the 6 months bridge course over the country. It depends on the country. If we go to Canada, there is no any requirement to conduct this course. But in USA, definitely we need to take 6 months bridge gap courses for that.
Thank you, Amit sir, for answering this. And the one more question which has popped up is in the chat box, that does internship will be provided in this course for practical knowledge, and what about our placement? Two questions are clubbed in one. Ashwini madam, could you throw some light on this?
Can you repeat, Namrata?
Yeah, does internship will be provided in this course, number one, for practical knowledge? And the second is, what about the placement? The concern is for placement.
Third trimester, we have written in the course curriculum about the project work. It will be survey project. And the students, we will give them the letter, consent letter, and hospital will allow them to do the research project in the hospital. And they can spend the time, how much time they have given the permission for. And this we call internship because it is a PG diploma program. We don't give the continuous internship for 3 months or so. That will be in the master's program, but here in PG diploma part-time program, they are given the permission to visit any hospital for their survey project. And regarding the placement, we have the linkages with the major hospitals, and our advisory committee is also having the members from the corporate hospitals. So we will try our level best for finding the placement in the hospital, because if we will allow them to access, because nowadays the jobs are available on the net also, they can find out of the jobs in the healthcare industry. But we will definitely apply our relationship and help them to get the good placement.
Just to add on that part, IU has its own internship and placement cell, which helps every student to get internship as well as placement. It is our motto that whoever pass out gets placed, and we are trying to achieve that 100% placement year on year. So we are in touch with a lot of industry, and for here also for hospital industry, it is our core to make sure that the students get placed.
Thank you, Abhinand sir, for completing it. I'm sure Shastri might have got the answer. And as of now, I don't see any other question except for one question to Amit sir, that if it is possible, by Dr. Vishal, if it is possible to get the recording, especially the PPT, you know, which has interested this person. I said only with the permission.
Facebook live part to him, probably he can visit there.
Yes, that also is possible. We are actually streaming it live on Facebook, and they may get the recording of this entire webinar through Facebook, so they can rehear and can refer to that. Thank you. Thank you, Abhinand sir. And before we wrap up, I thank everyone, because it is customary to thank everyone. And Ashwini madam, would you like to have concluding remarks on the session by Amit sir?
Amit sir has given the broad summary, broad knowledge about this industry and what are the opportunities and how innovations are taking place, and new avenues open. He gave the detail about how we are running short of healthcare professional, even the hospital shortages, bed shortages, and lot of opportunities in the new areas like digital therapeutics and artificial intelligence, wearable and mobile equipments. Even robotics. So hospital chains are expanding on the basis of technology advancement platform. And he gave one information that too much of proliferation in this local clinics, small and mid-sized hospitals. And I always feel that in future, again, small and mid-sized will be hospitals will be at the top, and a lot of opportunities. He told about it, and he gave the 10 healthcare trends and innovations in 2021. And new area of genomics is an upcoming area, and in hospital itself also, there are various departments. There are two parts: administrative part. Yeah, and management part, clinical and non-clinical. So and so many services are outsourced. So the people who get the employment in the hospital, they have a lot of opportunity to grow themselves in that area. And even many of them can go for entrepreneurship, because dietary services and other services, pharma services, these are all outsourced, even bioengineering. So a lot of opportunity will open, even in the public sector also. After post-COVID, government, private and public sector both joined their hands, and public sector is expanding their infrastructure, and the quality of the services, now they are also focusing on managerial skills. They are not focusing on just providing the medicine, but they are upgrading their system. So a lot of opportunities will be there. As Amit bhai told, that in public and private sector both. And this program, whatever, with postgraduate diploma in hospital management, we are providing to develop this students for any sector, whether it is a public sector or the private sector. So a lot of opportunities on the administrative side and the management side. The people who become knowledgeable and skilled with us through this program, this type of programs, they get better promotion and upgradation in the hospitals.
Thank you, madam, for summing up the entire session by Amit sir, Vyas sir, and Abhinand sir. This is an open forum, and before we wrap up, if you want, then we can have the reflections, and then we'll proceed forward. Thanks. Abhinand sir.
First of all, I'd like to thank you, Amit ji, for giving such a wonderful presentation. Actually, he has covered all the span from present day need, the demand supply gap, which actually is in India, you know, the per bed 1,000, you know, that's a huge requirement for India. And we have seen that lacuna in the our healthcare system in the present COVID time. You know, our system was forced to stress test in April. We have seen actually people running around for beds in April. And that's where we see that there is a huge scope over there for hospital. And when the hospital is there, there is a requirement for related infrastructure, related scope for administrative staff, your nursing staff, management staff, everything is required. And as and when the healthcare goes into the quality circle, you require quality people to get into quality output to the patient. Every patient is looking forward to its quality outcome. Doctor do their job. But ultimately, after, you know, do this surgery for 1.5 hours, it is left to the administrative staff and the nursing staff. Now you are able to manage the patient, how you are able to give them very quality experience. It is there. And that's why, you know, people are now going throwing towards JCI accredited hospital to get to the next level of gold standards. And the, we want to teach, you know, our course curriculum is designed to teach them with regulatory standard so that they come to the next level of administrative head, the next level of leaders into this healthcare system. And yes, perfectly taken how next level IoT and other things are going, you know. Medtronics is coming with a lot of fabulous devices. If you look at Philips, they're also working. So it is going to the next level of healthcare system. You know, you are taking everything from the home, telemedicine is there. So remote workplace. So there is a huge opportunity for it. You just need an attitude and a good mentor to learn the skills, and then you can go to the next level of corporate hospital. The sky is the limit. Thank you, Amit bhai, for educating all everybody and giving such a wonderful thoughts and wonderful presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Abhinand sir, for your reflections. It was nicely briefed what Amit sir has shared with us. And especially there is huge opportunity when he has cited the statistics wherein, you know, 8 crore you know, health workers are required by 2030. So certainly this program is going to benefit all those who are being right now. And I now wrap up this entire session, starting with expressing my thanks to Amit sir. I also thank Ashwini madam for being with us, Dr. Vyas, Dr. Bharti Dave, both deans at Indrashil University, Abhinand sir, strategic project manager at Indrashil University, and also with the experience in hospital sector, he is going to take some case studies in this course. So I also thank all the audience who are watching till now, and the technical support and management of Indrashil University. Thank you. Stay safe. Stay healthy. Yes. Okay.